Hi, I am N2RJ, Rhea, and today we're going to answer your questions. So one of the questions that was asked that I came across was, somebody heard people talking on a repeater, and then somebody said, I'm going to drop to let it reset. What does that mean? So long story short, a repeater generally has a timer that starts when you transmit and then is released after, say, 90 seconds or so. And this is done to prevent somebody from just keying up the repeater and keeping it open and transmitting for a long time, possibly damaging the repeater. But it's a little more complicated than that. So as you know, a repeater is a device that takes a signal on one frequency and then retransmits it on another. But the way it does that is it doesn't just keep receiving and transmitting continuously. It turns the transmitter and the repeater on and off as needed. So it receives an input signal. When it detects an input signal, it will then turn on the transmitter, key the transmitter, and then it will continue to transmit until that signal or a signal on the input is gone. Well, let's just say the repeater has a defect where it just keeps transmitting and will not unkey. Let's say somebody's transmitter has a defect where it won't unkey. Let's say there is some sort of interference. Let's say there is interference where some signal got into the input or repeater and just keeps it open. What happens in that case? Let's say somebody decides to maliciously jam the repeater. Do you want to give them that satisfaction of keeping the repeater open all day? No. Well, in jest, really, it's not really for their satisfaction, but it's to protect the repeater. So what you do is you have this timer. So the timer starts counting down from 90 seconds to zero when you open the squelch and repeater, which is when you transmit. Once you transmit and you're near the end, a lot of operators will keep a watch on how long they've been transmitting, or they might figure, well, you know, it's time. Then they say, I'm going to pause for reset. So they unkey their transmitter, they let it drop, and then when they let it drop, it resets the timer. The repeater, of course, stops transmitting, and then you can go and reset. And then when you key up again, you start the timer all over again. An important side effect of this that one might not have considered. So let's say, and by the way, this letting the repeater drop is very common during net operation. Let's say you have a net in progress, and the net controller is talking about all the things of the net, the purpose of the net, why we do this, that, and the other. And some nets will pause specifically for this that I'm going to explain, but let's say they pause for a reset. What happens? Let's say somebody has an emergency. Let's say somebody has emergency or priority traffic they need to deliver, but they can't do it while the person is transmitting. So what they do is they have to wait until there's an opening, and then they say their call sign to get in, and then they will be able to pass the traffic. Well, that doesn't always work. There's not always a break if somebody keeps transmitting for a long time. Maybe they're just, I don't know, they're long-winded. There's a lot of hams that are long-winded. So this break with the repeater where it tells somebody to basically, after a certain period of time, to reduce the transmission time, to basically drop the repeater, unkey, give somebody the opportunity to come in with an emergency or priority message, which actually helps out a lot in ham radio. So, all right, so that is the timeout timer explained, and I hope that answered your question. So one question I get asked a lot is, I have coax. I know what kind of coax to use, but what kind of connector do I use? Excellent question. And maybe I need to do a whole video on connectors. What do you think? Why don't you tell me in the comments below? And by the way, if you have any questions, you can also leave them in the comments below. So my philosophy on connectors, on coax connectors, is this. If I have something that connects to a piece of equipment like a radio, I'm going to use what's there. And I'm going to use what's there on the internal part of the shack. Outside, basically anything goes. In my station, I use end connectors. And I use end connectors for one big reason. They were available, and they were what I use on the type of coax that I use. I use hardline Andrew Heliox on my coax in my station. And the most available type of connectors were end connectors. On the inside of the shack, I use the common UHF connector, also known as PL259. And it's fine to use PL259 up till I think 70 centimeters, when there is a slight, you know, degradation at 70 centimeters. And beyond that, I would really use type N. But for most HF ham radio, I would use the PL259. Now, when you get into the above UHF, still in the UHF region, probably 900 megahertz, 1.2 gig, and you get into the microwaves, 1.2 gig, you get into 2.4 gig. That's when you're looking to use lower loss connectors. Like I said, let me know if you want me to do a whole video on connectors, because I have a lot of different types in the shack, and I really think that it deserves its own video. So I think I'll probably just go ahead and do it anyway. All right, so that's that question answered. The last question I was asked, well, that I saw was, we have the 630 and 2200 meter bands. Why do they exist and how do we use them? So that one is actually a pretty interesting question. The 630 and 2200 meter bands were partially, and they were pretty much the result of the community and the ARRL lobbying to get spectrum below 160 meters for experimentation. So back in the early days of 200 meters and down, if you ever read that book, it's a good book by Clinton B. DeSoto. It explains the history of ham radio, where the Federal Radio Commission at that time decided to basically throw all hams off any frequency that was deemed useful. Back in those days, the frequencies that were deemed useful for commercial traffic, especially ships, was frequencies below 200 meters in wavelength. So this was roughly, I would say, sort of in the upper end of the AM broadcast band and the lower frequencies, because these propagated well over water. Well, as hams discovered, as we pretty much do a lot of times, sometimes maybe what they throw away is still valuable. One man's trash is another man's treasure. And it turned out that way for hams. We discovered that you can actually use these higher frequencies on short waves and have good propagation across the world. And eventually they discovered it and they began to use it as well. They, meaning the FRC and Federal Radio Commission, predecessor to the Federal Communications Commission and the world of commercial radio. But hams were still thrown off of these lower bands. And there were hams who want to experiment on that frequency, range, on those wavelengths. Why? Well, you know what? We like new frontiers. We like to experiment. We like to do the radio science and such like that. And those bands were never really used by most modern day hams. They were used by probably Hiram Percy Maxim and those back in the day, probably. But they were not used by, you know, modern hams. So we lobbied to get those frequencies. You know, we tried to get 500 kilohertz frequency as a ham frequency because it was an international frequency used for calling frequency used for ships, but we're not successful. But we did get 630 meters, which is in the 470 kilohertz range. And we got 2200 meters, which is in the 137 kilohertz range. And those actually have some pretty interesting propagational characteristics. For one, the antennas are going to be very large, obviously. The other thing is, a lot of these signals will follow the ground wave, meaning that they will stay closer to the Earth's surface. They don't really have that much ionospheric propagation, I believe. At least not as well as the higher bands, like the short waves, like 20 meters, 40 meters and such. But they are going to be useful for experimentation. And there are quite a few people using them. Now, one thing you have to understand is that those bands are being used by electric utilities for control signals on some of their gear. And as such, part of the agreement we had to get that band is that we had to register our locations with the government to ensure that we do not interfere with the utilities. But the upside is, once we register, there will be no utility use of the band in that area. So I encourage everyone to register. And it's a good way to learn new frontiers, even if you just listen. Most of the stuff in that band is either CW or Whisper, one of the digital modes. Joe Taylor has a new mode that's actually designed for that band. So when we do the video on it, we're going to cover that as well. All right, that's it for Q&A this time around. See you next time. I think this was fun. Maybe I'll do more of it. Let me know what you think. Give me a like, give me a thumbs up, share, like, and subscribe. Helps keep this channel growing and keeps me making more videos. Thanks. See ya.